every time I lift up my hands, yeah. Gotta say thank you, thank you. Come on, say it.
Every time I lift up my voice,
thank you, oh, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Every time I get a chance,
I wanna say thank you. Hey, thank you for being God.
We appreciate your goodness, Father.
Thank you for being God.
Thank you, Lord.
You turned my whole world upside down.
Said you came into my life, turned me around. Love me so much.
Thank you for loving me.
I can never repay you.
Earlier this year, I had the privilege of going to Israel with Kathy Lee Gifford, and we did a music film to a song that God allowed us to write together. And just like we were just singing, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. A part of the song is a reminder, and it simply says, and I will be a ring of fire. To your knees, and I will lift you up again. sees. And it's so good to know that the God who sees is also the same God who redeems. And he buys back our pain and our heartache. Yo sé que vive mi redentor. Yo sé que vive mi redentor. La creación declara la vida.
Together, praise God, praise Him. Yes, our Redeemer lives. He lives, praise God, He lives. It's a wonderful thing that He lives, because if He did not live, our gospel would be in vain. It would have no validity if Christ did not live. If we did not believe that we serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. Oh, praise God, this Ambassador L.F. Craig of the Shelter, God's Safe House, and In the Know for New Life. Get in the know today. and you can change your every tomorrow. You need to know what drives your faith, because everybody has faith, but it's what you have faith in. And what's driving your faith? What keeps you going? What's the root of why you're doing what you're doing, or why you believe what you believe? Do you believe that Jesus is the savior of your life? No, he came to save the world, but do you believe that he is the savior and the redeemer of your life? Oh, praise God. We're going to continue our reading of Hebrews. We are in chapter number 6. So I pray that you would read and reread and pray that the Spirit will open up your eyesight on some things. This particular chapter, when I'm going to read through, say a few points, because this is one of those chapters, is a fall from grace chapter that was taught and may still be taught because of not rightly dividing the word of God and looking at what the Greek means and the original writing of the text, as opposed to what our English definitions may possibly be. So this is one of those books and chapters that you really need to get to the origin of. And you need to see that one word can mean several different things. So what does it mean in the context of this particular chapter? Okay, because we have seen people. That's the grace. He says, confess your faults, and he's faithful and just to forgive you. And so we're just going to look at, so I'm going to read through it, and I'm going to pray that you reread through it, and that you'll pray and ask the Spirit of God to give you what you need. If you have some questions that you want to ask, please inbox me. You can inbox me on Messenger, DM me, that's what they say, DM me, and I will get back with you. If not, when at the close of reading chapter 13, which would be next week. So this week we read chapter 5 yesterday. We're reading chapter 6 today, which is Tuesday. We're going to read chapter 7 and 8. We're going to read 7. We're going to split it up because it's the longest of the chapters. So we're going to split 7 up for Wednesday and Thursday. And on Friday, we're going to read chapters 8. Next week, we're going to read 9 through 13. If the Lord bless and say the same, that's what we are going to do. That's what we are preparing for. That's what we have put together to do on our chunk and our chew, our word for today. And so let's just get to our word for the day. And I pray, because it's very essential. We talked about yesterday when you have to go back and read chapter number 5. You have to read the last 3 verses of chapter 5 in order to understand this therefore. And so if you see a therefore, you need to find out what is therefore. And because you ought to be eating meat, but you are on milk, you should be teachers, but yet you need someone to sit down with you and go back over the foundational principles. He said, therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, to maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. In other words, we're going back around this, that you got to do this and you got to do that. We going back to Judaism as opposed to this law of grace. So we want to go back into the old covenant. Okay, so we having to go back and discuss, well, what do this mean? And we do a lot of preaching and teaching from the Old Testament, but we really going to have to get to the point where we start teaching people about what they have in Christ Jesus under the new. We don't know enough about salvation. That's why we all stressed out, because we just don't know how to rest. We don't know how to come into the rest of God. We don't understand. We don't come. Okay. I just want to read it because there's a whole lot in here. I want to teach it, But the Spirit of God is telling me, read through it, because I am a teacher, and we do teach our students. Read it and then go back. Okay. Read through it twice at least. Okay. So we had verse number 2. Of the doctrine of baptism, of laying on hands, of resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And this we do if God permits. For it's impossible for those who were once enlightened and has tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the power of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God and put him to an open shame, for the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes up on it and bears herbs useful for those by whom it is cultivated, receives blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and briars, it is rejected and near to being cursed, whose end is to be burned. But beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you. Yes, things that accompany salvation, though we speak in this manner. For God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, that you don't become lazy, you don't become weary, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Okay. For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by one greater, he swore by himself. Okay. And when God make a promise, he made an eternal promise to Abraham. He's bound to keep it because he gave his word. And however that looks, God has to stand by his word. Surely blessing, I will bless you, and multiplying, I will multiply you. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Okay. God blessed him with many children. But men indeed swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is for them an end of all disputes. So that's why you have to make sure that you don't make no vow that you ain't able to keep. Thus God determining to show more abundance to the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. Okay. That by two immutable things, unmovable, you can't denounce them. They are firmly fixed. There is proven, is solid, in which it is impossible for God. First, two things. The first thing, it is impossible for God to lie. Okay. We might have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope set before us. This hope we have as an anchor of God, and he's true to his word, to immutable God, and he cannot lie, his word. This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enters the presence behind the veil. Jesus Christ, our high priest, have torn the veil. And we can enter in where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. And we're going to talk about him. He was a priest that had no parents. He has no beginning. He has no end. But God is the only one that was always. So who was this person, this high priest? God put him on the scene, but all creation is not just Adam and Eve. This is our chunk and our chew. Ask God for insight. And believe me, you are fruited and gifted, and the Holy Spirit that dwells within me dwells within you. And he will, she will, the Spirit of God, because God is a spirit. He's not bound by gender. Just in case some of you have that problem, he's not bound by gender. He's neither male nor female, Greek nor Jew. He's a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And the Spirit indwells us, and you need to let the Spirit infill you, fill you up. And so be blessed and know that you are fruited and gifted. Pull your gift out, share it with the world, share it with yourself. Find out what it is that God has called you to and for in this time that we live in, and come and enter. One of the things I know for sure, he has called us to be ambassadors in earth, and he has called us to enter his rest. God bless you, my brothers and my sisters. I love you with the love of Jesus.
In my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day. Still, that a hope that lies within is reassured as I keep my eyes upon the distant shore. I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. But Pharaoh, I'm the breaker.